Macmillan Audio presents Everything and Nothing at Once, a Black man's reimagined soundtrack for the future. Written and read for you by me, Joél Leon. Dedicated to Linda T. and Charles Lorenzo. Great trees bear miraculous fruit. Thank you for tending to my garden as best as you could. This book is my offering back to you. I love you. I'm just like everybody else, man. An average nigga with above average potential. You know what I mean? De La Soul, The Grind Date, featuring Bones Malone. I have spent my entire writing life trying to make sure that the white gaze was not the dominant one in any of my books. Toni Morrison. What kind of black are you? All I've ever done, all I've ever known to do, is make a home out of language. I wrote my first book at 14 years old. That book currently sits in a box in the closet of my old bedroom in my mother's apartment in the Bronx. The book started across two summers. The summer spent in Baton Rouge, Louisiana with my cousins, and the summer spent in Indianapolis with my sister Tanja. I didn't know I had a sister until I was 10 years old, her being the offspring of my father who, unbeknownst to my brother and me, had a previous relationship before he met my mother. My cousin Leah gave me a collection of African-American essays and poems written between the 1800s and the early 1970s, a foundation for my exploration into blackness. My summer with my sister, my nephews, and my then brother-in-law, Sean, offered me three things: a newfound work ethic, the church, and puberty. Sean would have me trail him from salon to salon while he got his and my sister's business off the ground, a clothing boutique bringing the fashions of New York City to the Midwest. I spent days hauling plastic bags full of NYC, Car Canai, and Avirex gear. Think of Tyrese's character in the film Baby Boy, but with a teenage sidekick to drive up the cuteness ratio. Outside of the grueling heat and sense of civic duty required to sell gear to black women looking to style their kiddos and beaus, I was also doing a lot of reading and a lot of church going. My Indianapolis summers also put me in a recording studio for the first time. Sean wanted to promote their clothing business, so he enlisted me and a couple of the younger church boys to essentially record rap jingles. They wrote theirs, I freestyled mine off the top of my head for the duration of the session. The summer prior to that in Baton Rouge had me go to my first party. A fight almost broke out between two rival neighborhoods. The security guard working the event plainly explained to the high-strung teens, "Y'all got all these girls in here, and y'all want to fight?" Those summers began Bloodlines, my collection of essays, all handwritten, where I began exploring language. It was the first time outside of the little poems I would write in grade school for homies trying to mac to the girls in our school and the sports column I wrote for our grade school newspaper that I had started putting pen to paper to speak to the things I was still learning the language for. Every rap, every poem, and every essay since then has been reintroducing myself to myself for the first time. This endeavor is no different, I suppose. I am both greeting and grieving myself. There are endings and beginnings. As a black father to two black girls, there is rarely, if ever, a moment when I am not fully aware of what that means within the context of the world we are living in today. There is almost always something at stake, something to live for and fight for. And isn't that what manhood is supposed to be? If it is not hard or difficult, then it must not be worth it. But I've decided for myself, for my girls, for my partner, and family and friends and community, I want ease above all else. I want to make and leave room for a different way of being that doesn't subscribe to the notion that our pain, suffering, and trauma need to play a starring role in the stories of being. The greeting of myself is the reintroduction. Lauryn Hill talks about having to reintroduce herself to her parents because there was a shift, a transformation. And while doing so, there was also a dying. For in the rebirth, there is also a conclusion, a burying of what needs to die to allow something new to live. It feels at times that collectively we are at the intersections of both. I found it most helpful to meet the expansiveness of the moment by expanding right along with it. We are achieving so much and yet, in parallel, are losing so much in the process. This time we're in feels like a reflection point, an opportunity to sit with what was and has been, and the potential in what could be. And that potential is love. Blackness is love to me. To be loved is also very black. And if we are looking at blackness through that lens, then that love exists beyond a romantic sense of love and travels deeper into the vortex of humanity as a whole. Because to embody the fullness of blackness and the spectrums of black masculinity that exist within that framework, we get to reimagine what blackness means with a new set of eyes and a new set of rules to play with. I love being black. Being black is a birthright privilege and a rite of passage, like learning how to parallel park or double dutch. But just as much as I love being black, I love being able to say I'm black. The ability to speak, to use words, to use language, that ability to speak to a truth, to our ancestors, I'm in love with that too. I'm in love with language, with the languid and the lusty, with the length of a page and latitude of a levee breakage. It is this love of words and their use that has moved me to look at blackness. Being black is a noun and a verb. I learned this by looking in mirrors, staring at my reflection, standing naked and seeing black skin, black body, my blackness staring back at me. I saw a thing being. And leaving my family's two-bedroom apartment on Creston Avenue in the Bronx, going outside showed me what black was also doing. Doing blackness as a person living and breathing, dapping up elders, ducking into bodegas for bacon, egg, and cheese sandwiches, reciting rap lyrics I learned from Video Music Box and snippets of the cassette tapes my big brother D would cop near the D train on Fordham Road in the Bronx. Growing up, I learned that being black is an all-encompassing everything. It is both whirlwind and movement, progress and processed hair. It is fistfights and chicken spots with fried chicken at the end of each title. It is liquor in barbershops and boyfriends in hair salons. It is long acrylics like Coco from the girl group SWV wore in her falsetto high notes during Showtime at the Apollo. Her stiletto heels set the benchmark for anything vocals related in R&B videos during my formative 1990s years. These videos and the blackness in them are what my younger self would watch and stare at. Their blackness and the volume in them staring right back. I'd be looking at all the caramel black girls with the door knockers on, clutching their earlobes to the ends of the earth, weave tips reaching their waists. I say caramel because it was also here where I learned that light skin was preferable, that colorism was a pseudonym for acceptable. These are all constructs, binaries meant to be broken and laid out on the living room carpet for us all to bear witness to. A collective sigh of relief that the baggage of titles and labels can be eschewed for a higher sense of being and self we often aren't afforded the luxury to have. Early on, I learned that masculinity for a black man is a tapestry of images pulled together from the media portrayals of what you were supposed to have. The exotic, light-skinned, curly-haired girl in oat clothes modeling for cameras. The car with the roof missing, money flying out of the windows, gold chains attached to bodies like tattoos. To be black, to be a black man in the era I grew up in, was easily everything and nothing at once. And to exist in that, to have that live both in you and on you, like a tattoo that is at once foreign and also embedded in you with the ink forever drying, is a hard thing to grapple with. The totality of that experience is also hard to put into words. Much of my journey and purpose has been in translating my blackness and my experiences surrounding blackness, not for white eyes or the white gaze, but for black folks who have struggled with having the language to describe how they view the world. The words and ways of expression I lacked then now show up in the prosaic language I use to illustrate those times now. This language is now more visual than anything else. And as I've gotten older, the language I have learned to use to express my blackness has shifted. Blackness has shifted. It was me walking the streets of New York on sunshine-soaked summer days. Me and the ragtag assembled crew of hood boogers trapezing the block, looking for somebody else's parked car to perch on. In those days, we'd sit idle and watch our older brothers and friends passing a brown paper bag or a football around while the stories were rehashed. Who fucked whom? Who shot whom? Who got slapped for what? We'd wait to be called in for a game, and some of us would have already had a pass of whatever was in the crinkled container that shielded the rest of the world from its contents. In those days, we did not punctuate words and did not use the right grammar in any of our sentences. In that era of blackness, we were reckless and carefree enough to pee in the streets, pants hung low, eyes glued to the concrete. In that era, I wanted a gold chain. We all wanted a gold chain because your gold chain was your flex. So was your car, your light-skinned girlfriend, your peace, your J's. I wanted, but couldn't afford, so therefore I couldn't have. All of these things attached to what I thought I was supposed to be as a black man. That language was forcibly handed to me, a language I was told to own by others who had been told to do the same without question. We learned this language because we were taught this language of mistrust, of machismo by any means. I thought I was close to what I believed was the right way to be black and had the right kind of language needed to survive. But then I'd watch Martin and see how fucked up Martin was to Gina and how light she was and how dark Pam was, but Pam was the butt of every joke. I'd laugh because they were telling us how to be black men. No one tells us that our manhood is not about black women or white supremacy or fire hoses, about lusting after white women or lean or black and milds. Not about Mike Brown or Jim Brown or James Brown or OJ running in the airport or driving in the Bronco during the Knicks versus Rockets final. Not about Lucy's or I can't breathe or asking for your dead mama for 9 minutes with a knee in your neck, or about knowing the math and supreme knowledge. That's because no one taught us feelings. Nobody taught black boys how to feel things. No one around us knew how. No one told us feeling things mattered just as much as the things you wanted on your neck, in your wallet, in your pants. What I did learn from the culture, what I absorbed growing up, was that white would always be right, that black women were side characters or non-existent, that black men were good for comic relief but not good enough for names and title cards at the beginning of any sitcom, that black death was a laugh track, that if I just worked as hard as the white people on TV, I could be successful on my terms. And maybe I didn't aspire to that success, but I could see it in my peripheral, knowing it was there. The same way I would watch TV and I'd see the hot white girl, never the hot black girl. The black girl was never labeled as hot or a catch. Sometimes the black girl wasn't even on screen. And when she was, she wasn't the star, she wasn't painted as desirable. I learned it but didn't know I was learning it. None of us did. This was the language they gave us. The language we never asked for. I came up with my own. Here are my 10 Be a Better Black Man commandments. Commandment 1. Number 1. If you're a good guy, you don't gotta keep saying you're a good guy. In fact, just stop saying who and what you are and A, let others do that for you, and B, just do the things that show who you are. Normally, it's the dude puffing his chest out in the quest to be the almighty alpha who has the least valuable thing to add to the conversation. Also, just shut the fuck up more often. Period. Commandment 2. Number 1, if she turns you down, walk away, Holmes. Like, really. Do some yoga, contemplate life, jog around the block, call your moms. Number two, whatever. Number three, but whatever you do, leave her the fuck alone, bruh. Commandment three. Number one, give up your seat, fam. On the bus, on the train. Like, I get it. You had a hard day, too. You was at your desk flirting with your work wife, or you was standing up all day at the construction site working for the man. I feel you. But she had to go through shit you can't even fathom. Plus, just a nice fucking thing to do. It ain't that serious. Number two, you can sit your ass down when you get home. I know you got a couch at the crib, Shun. Commandment four. Number one, be honest. Like, I done had some very fuck boy moments. I've lied, I've cheated, made promises I ain't keep, ran from situations with no real explanation as to why. Number two, all you got is your word. Stand by it. Number three, stand behind it. If you are honest from the jump, it just saves you a whole lot of trouble. Someone may still get hurt or even hate your existence, but hey, at least you can say you were up front. Intentions are everything. Everything. Be aware of yours. Be honest with the people in your life, but most importantly, be yourself. Commandment five. Number one, stop trying to police feelings, hair, body parts, clothing. Number two, just stop. Number three, yes, we live in a free society with free will. Deal. People will do and or say what they want, how they want, and when they want to do it. Number four, yes, you can have it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.